moment, there is not a precise aim. So we ask people to sit in this cabin out of styrofoam.
Styrofoam.
And just give us a time without precise images. And we collect this time at the end in 4 or 5 minutes. But the important thing for us what we get in this discussion is with people who ask the images and they ask why shall we do it. Another third is in Germany. We collected also voices. We collected voices of people that are living in the camps, Palestinian people who immigrated from Palestine to Jordan. They lived there since 3 generations, and we went there and asked people to count the years since the birth until now and in the future as far as they want. I can maybe just show a small how we can do art in public space. And they changed from originally a sculpture exhibition to a performance exhibition. And we did a work that called, also this little subject, that's called Three Circles. And as you see in the map, these are three circles, more or less. And during 3 days, a specific group of persons were walking all the time. And the one group was were artists. They walked the biggest circle. One group were migrants from other asylum seekers. Was from Ethiopia and Tibet. No, no, and these were sex workers walking. And it was a mostly invisible bird because you cannot recognize these groups. But we had some kind of a center where we met.
You mean where the circles come together?
Yes, but it also was some kind of a cafe or a room space. People could have a rest, have a coffee. And, well, maybe it's to tell that in my atelier in Zurich, where I live, is in an overland where they build containers, houses of containers for the artists, for the asylum seekers, and behind for the prostitutes. But we don't have really, we are not really in touch with each other. We are out of the center, and the artists are also there. They have a little bit of a special role to make it a little bit more nice, more modern. Well, I understood that I should also talk about dialogue, and as dialogue is for me very central research thing, auditive, and therefore I want to show you.
Ad vi funktionieras?
And the answer was, no, I don't understand a can understand all these other languages. And I like it very much because it's in plural, it's more language, but it's all in German or Austrian. That it's everybody's talking another language for him, and he cannot get into it, and he cannot like anybody. And I think that is a good point to mistrust. I'll show you this piece and then.
I'm you. Ja, aber der Rückenteil der beiden Kastelle und Kopf ist ein. Was bedeutet das Wort? Kiesel auf Kopf ist.
That's not for public space, no. That's just a normal concert piece. It's more about the theme. Yeah, it's like a stage.
Description of the best way to build ships, looking at the maritime history of San Francisco, all the way through to modernist authors that talk about this city. Every time they walked through the door, in their switching of the ability of sound into layer environments and to superimpose something. Which leads me back to listening posts, which is going to be shown in our project. This was also shown in another carbon art festival, but it's art not places in New York City. So though this work has been shown before, the content changes each time. The form remains the same, but it responds to each site in its own way. And so looking at this work in terms of dialogue, I'm hoping to get people to be able to open up the city as this narrative space, to see alternative dialogues that exist without us really knowing that are more temporal and ephemeral. And then this is for the website, if anyone who's interested and wants to know more.
To me, the question of public becomes also a question of people. So who comes to the space and how do they form? So there are recent events in this street that global history that tell us that publics, people together are a thing, are a form. And I'm interested in exploring this, how do we come together, this form that we create collectively with others. So there are two images from different recent attacks in Paris and what happened after the politicians coming out in the streets and protesting. So normally you see a politician addressing directly the crowd. In this case, they were coming together to create this different body. So that idea that into this project, which was produced in the Philippines, it's called the People's Island, and the concept is, or the idea behind it is to create a sort of space that didn't exist unless people came together. Explore this idea that reality is not other but the things we do together. So togetherness was kind of the core. The project started with this parade since March to the waterfront, as you see in that picture. When people arrived to the waterfront, which is normally where art happens, they were not there. And slowly, boats started to arrive, and this platform was released. And this platform, again, following the drift project, was a platform that allowed performers to be part of this and complete the performance. So the idea that this island was this more abstract space that would form and come together when people gather together. This is an image of the space. The other boats would also gather around us. So again, thinking about public and let's say dialogue, it's not only about what happens in public space with the public, but how these people come together and actually how art sort of enables this community engagement. So sort of sometimes careful to address or think about a project in a community. I actually think about the project forming a community. So this project was in Bogota, Colombia, 2009. It's called the Ephemeral Museum of Venice, in a neighborhood, a working class neighborhood called Venice. So this building was made out of ephemeral materials, and then it became a museum, and we had a collection of artworks, copies that were commissioned to different artists, art students in the city. Why? Because in this region of Bogota, which is quite a large city, there is a lack of museums, a lack of cultural institutions. And we were thinking, we were thinking about what the conversations that are possible in art, and how sometimes we look at our history through books that hardly ever have a direct contact with this painting. So allowing this space for people to experience art directly, but at the same time come together, was a kind of a very specific task. But then, at the same time, it was kind of posing a question in public space, which was, what is the role of architecture, what is the role of this site? So in this case, the museum, the ephemeral museum, was built on this unfinished community center in Venice neighborhood, where we also ran this festival for a number of years, the Venice Biennale of Bogota. Okay, so I think I probably will show this as the last project. It's called We Paint Houses. It's a performance that happened in the US. I was invited to present this project in some places, but in this case it's in Philadelphia, in a gallery called Practice Gallery, where they show performance and socially engaged art. So the idea is that I created this business, temporary business, a house painting business, with the help of day laborers. Mostly undocumented day laborers. So migrants who come to the US to work and to make money. So normally their working conditions are not great. They work underground. They don't have a contract or they cannot because they're sort of care paying for their jobs. But anyhow, we advertised around the city and the idea is that people would call us and we would deliver, say yes, we will paint your house and kind of run this as a proper operation. But then arrive to the place and deliver a performance of a house painting. So we would come with the overalls, buckets, and set up these easels and start creating the painting of the house. So the point was to kind of explore what happened in this translation process, because the owner of the house was expecting a very cheap job to be done. But at the same time, we were being very literal and straightforward, because what we were doing, we were painting houses. But the surprise was that probably there was cultural element added, which is migrant workers are expected to deliver. We paint houses. Also, if you see the last project, it was a very interesting encounter with the house owner of passerby, because they were interested in what was happening. And you needed to create a conversation about the conditions of these migrant workers and the role of the artist, the role of the labor, the worker, what's the labor. And then actually the working conditions of these two parties. We created some of the paintings which were then presented again at the gallery, and these paintings were auctioned. So these paintings entered the art market and were sold. Some of them quite high, I think that one person paid about a couple hundred dollars for one painting. But to me it was interesting because they access this economy of art, which is also unclear rules. So technically it created a new potential for the labor, these undocumented workers, to be valid in the US.
and of course, the other thing was to test my thesis that who gets to be an artist in the public depends a great deal on who you are and how you look. So it turns out that being a 30-year-old white woman is an excellent demographic if you ever want to become a career criminal in New York City. They're painted, yes, they're all painted.
But on the spot.
On the spot, yes. So I had some exciting experiences with the police. And then this guy whose mural I was tagging, and he was just like, "You're doing it all wrong, it's too small. You'll never get famous like this." So, and they called them all over the city.
Absolutely.
And at the end, there's some of them. I made a map, because of course, if it's a public art project, it has to have a map. No map. All these people went to these horrible locations, which were all very smelly, because that's how you could tell that it was a good place to break the laws. And of course, once you do one thing, people ask you again. So this is in Austria. But then they said, well, we'll find you a graffiti artist and we'll get you permission. And then I think, but then it's so boring. You should just let me tag the secession. And then, of course, I did get taken away by the police because Vienna. And it was illegal. So one of these things that I learned from being a short-term graffiti artist is if you are an artist in public, you are really performing being an artist. So I thought, well, yes, I should really perform being an artist. So we've all seen these people. This is a very hard job. So I decided that I was so bad at portraits that I would not charge people any money, but they would have to like do an evaluation of it. And then they could keep it, and I would, you know, I'd make a copy. And everyone hated their portraits. 100 people in New York were mad at me. They all didn't think they were beautiful enough. And then I did it 5 days later as part of the Whitney Biennial, and everyone loved their portraits. And I had not got any better. I think I had actually got worse. The other kind of public art that we see is people drawing on the pavement. So this is one that I made just, you know, people always making paintings, but I think carpets make more sense. And so then I put, at this point, actually this is not chronological because the first ever real public permanent piece of art I made was with Kendall, of all people. But this is one that is another very early public art piece where I made a carpet for people. Because when you're going to work, art is a public service, right? We feel better with a carpet, right?
But that was not a, that was permanent.
This is a mosaic, yes. So this is a mosaic. And this idea of art as somebody who just kind of does things that people might like to have, in this case, I put an advertisement in a newspaper after Hurricane Katrina, and I asked people to write to me what they had lost that was irreplaceable in this terrible hurricane. And I got 30 letters, and then I made paintings as gifts for people. This is somebody's house that they lost. This man lost all of his tools. This woman lost her partner. This cat got lost. And then we exhibited it with all the stories. So people came and you had your story, and it was called The Irreplaceable Cannot Be Replaced, because obviously if you lose your partner, a portrait is not really going to help. It's about the inadequacy of your attempt as an artist to do the right thing. Or doing something, in this case with a casino, these people, I offered people free lucky charms. But you had to leave your own lucky charm behind. So people left their own charms behind with photographs of why. And this was such an unlucky project that the whole thing got destroyed by accident. It took all the bad luck. So, yeah, right. I am very fast. So this idea of who the artist is can inform public art. But the other thing that, of course, we always think about is like where the artist is, the actual site. And so the other way, to, other than sort of saying, well, I'm going to perform being an artist for the public, is to say, well, what does this place actually want? Since I don't have very many ideas, I try to pay attention to where I am. And so in this case, this is a project that I did in the subway station with Kendall. It's a very large piece, and it shows you what you would see if you were not underground. So it shows you what you would see if you were above ground. So it's for everyone like me who never knows which direction they are facing. And for people who are claustrophobic as well. So it's you. This is another piece that tells you where you are. This is for the Yankee Stadium, for the baseball team in New York City. And they have this really embarrassing motto, in my opinion, which is the home of the stars. And so I thought, well, they had just opened their new stadium, so this is the sun. And then just because I just kept on being more neutral, this is for the Philadelphia Airport. This is called You Are Here, and that is where you are. So, again. But sometimes it's boring to tell the truth. So, and sometimes you want to tell a more interesting truth than just the physical truth. So, sites don't just exist as places, but they exist as histories and memories. In this case, I worked with the local community board in Bedford-Stuyvesant, which is an African-American, or traditionally African-American community in New York. And they told me all of what they thought were the most important sites in their community. And we use it to make a quilt mosaic for a meeting place in a new little park. It's like a secret history. And this is a church in Belgium, which they didn't want anymore. And this is it inside. This is it at the end of World War I. So the church had been built just after World War I. And then, you know how human beings are so perverse? You destroy a church, you build it, and then I just destroyed it again. So I took off the top, and the inside shows everything that is missing. So you see where the columns are, this is the altar, and this is the shadow of the old church. And now it's a sort of multi-use place for people in the community. They have parties, they do all kinds of concerts, they do all sorts of things. So it's a new space because they weren't using the church, but they needed a public space. And like I said, it is sometimes just more fun not to tell the truth. So this is a book I wrote for a park in Ghent, in Belgium. And it's a park that is called the Citadel Park, and it is mainly known for drugs and sex. Except that, of course, because it's Belgium, when I was there, I didn't see any drugs or sex, so I think they made it up. So, but to get people to come into the park, I made this guidebook, which we sent to everyone around the park. So this is the guidebook, which pretended to be by this famous English author who wrote about landscape. And so we then could go through the park, and we had these tours with glass of these mirrors that people used in the 18th century. And you could see all the different sites of great natural beauty in the park, like these two rocks. And then at the end, you went into the museum, and there was an archive of this supposed visit. The visit was from 1799. And of course, it was very obvious from my archive that this is all fake. So here we have some of the fictitious lovers. So hard. This is my friend on my side. So lest people think that sometimes the government doesn't have a sense of humor, this is a piece for the Internal Revenue Service, the tax authority in Massachusetts, and it is a big mirror that shows a drawing of their office as a ruin. destroyed with trees growing through it. I said it's for the future when we are all filing our taxes telepathically. And so just to be even clearer, out in their courtyard, and I made some fossils for them. And these are all fossils, computers, obviously. So I tried to move the Internal Revenue Service into the future. Unfortunately, the IT department thought this was a bit of a... And this is the last project I'm going to show. And in the States, an alien is not just somebody from outer space, but also somebody from somewhere else. So in Washington, D.C., I made guides to Washington, D.C. That were for extraterrestrials. But extraterrestrials in the future, when there is nothing left of the Earth except a lot of neoclassical ruins. So here's the very useful map. So there were thousands and thousands of these all over Washington, D.C. And then when you went to follow them, you could end up at the museum. And there, I copied a very beautiful sausage stand to make a stand for the alien visitors. And if you read the little alien's guide, it basically imagined that human beings, the lost pillar builders of Earth, were a telepathic species, which is why they always build the same thing. And they live in the oceans, and once a year they would all swim upstream to build pillars together and have sex. So this is the back of it, and Washington, D.C. and Nassau really look very similar in some ways. So many pillars. Which leads me to the piece that I'm going to do here, which is a little bit of a joke, of course, on this idea of artists who just show up somewhere and they're like, here is your new site-specific work. So, this is a souvenir stand, but it is for the wrong St. Petersburg. So, why not? I hope you enjoy it.
I'd like to thank you all for being here, and I'd like to especially thank Susan, Kendall, and Masha, as well as all of the CC curators and support staff, and all volunteers and project ambassadors. Contributions to the 2016 Art Prospect Festival includes a virtual public art project titled Portal to an Alternative Reality St. Petersburg. Built for a smartphone and other mobile devices, Portal to Alternative Reality allows people to explore a site-specific virtual reality scene from Wuhan, China, at the Anna Akhmatova Museum Garden using geolocated augmented reality technology. From a six-week residency in Wuhan, China, in central China, where I built the original portal to an alternative reality as part of the 01 American Arts Incubator, colleagues of Felipe in that program. The project used virtual and augmented reality technology to examine how change is being experienced by local people. Consider one of the fastest changing cities in China, Wuhan, just might be one of the fastest changing cities in the world. One of the most distinctive aspects of the city of Wuhan is the former foreign concessions. In the early 20th century, colonial powers were making incursions into central China along the Yangtze River. Many set up concessions or semi-autonomous trade zones along the banks of the river in Old Hangzhou, one of present-day Wuhan's three sister cities. Foreign concessions included Britain, France, Japan, and importantly, Russia. The U.S. never had owned a concession, but it was running gunboats on the Yangtze at the time. Virtual reality is a computer-generated environment that is presented to the user in such a way that she suspends disbelief and accepts it as real. Built in 1910, the former Russian concession, the palace of the Russian tea merchant, J.K. Panhoff, still stands. Once the richest man in China, Panhoff was a relative of Tsar Nicholai I, and he served as a Russian consul general of Hangzhou at the time. The Panhoff House was repurposed after the revolution and the founding of the Republic of China. Although today the building is in a state of disrepair, it has been the home to dozens of families since the founding of the People's Republic of China in 1949. The Panhoff House will no doubt be destroyed and redeveloped as luxury condominiums in the next few years. Either way, the current families will lose their homes and the close-knit social structures that the building has supported for over six decades. It's typically assumed that while experiencing virtual reality, the user is isolated from the surrounding world by some sort of headset viewing system. Geolocated augmented reality, on the other hand, engages the user with their surrounding by allowing people to experience alternative reality at site-specific locations through the camera of a mobile device. One can simply download and launch a free mobile app and aim for devices of the surrounding physical space. The app uses location detection technology to superimpose virtual objects, people, or scenes at precise GPS coordinates, enabling the user to immerse themselves in the work as if it existed in the real world. Photogrammetry is a technology used to create 3D models from the real world. A series of photographs taken at multiple angles can be analyzed, and the parallax differences of key features in the image can be measured and plotted on an X, Y, Z coordinate space. In addition to its position in space, each point is assigned an RGB color value. The result is referred to as a point cloud. The point cloud data can be converted into a polygon mesh or used in its original state to create virtual assets for use in virtual or augmented reality. This technology represents an important evolution in the history of photography, allowing the photographic image to be immersive and explorable. A geometric polygon model can be created by connecting the dots, so to speak. Here we have a virtual scene from Old Hangzhou. with the idea of creating physical structures to act as portals to virtual and augmented realities for a number of years now. MetroDex, with service in Zurich, included a replica of a vintage New York City subway entrance placed in Grand Central Station. But the station was simply placed on the marble floor and it led nowhere. Instead, as people made their way into the Grand Central Station and tried to enter the subway, they were confronted with iPads, and the iPads transported them to a virtual street scene from Zurich. They could also use their phones to explore the virtual Zurich.